Hello and welcome back to the channel. And let's begin with our third session in the course of automation and robotics. Today we will be talking about components of industrial robots. So this is the content of today's session. We will first talk about manipulators, which the different types of manipulators, specifically Cartesian, cylindrical, spherical, articulate, as well as SCADA. Then we will talk about the end effectors, specifically grippers as well as tools which are at the end of the robot. And finally, we will briefly talk about network-ready controllers such as Arduino and Raspberry Pi, but these will be very brief considering that these topics or these two controllers have their own detailed videos and channels. So the focus will be on the first two areas, which is manipulators and end effectors. So let's get right through it. So from the previous discussion, we agreed that robot manipulators are the first part of the robot. Essentially, it's the device that manipulates the position and orientation of the end effector so that the end effector can do its purpose, be it a gripper or a tool or anything else. Now, before we move on to the next few slides, I would like to show you this lovely video. The video actually provides excellent explanation into how these work, and it's available on this YouTube channel from this channel, Educational Videos and Lectures. I'm disabled the audio for this video because of interfering with my own audio, but I'll be explaining things as we watch. So it's just about 5 minutes, but it will make the job, or it will make things a lot easier for you to understand the concepts that we will discuss today. Trying to go through these concepts without visually see those robots or manipulators in action will be very difficult to do. So let's begin with it. So there's sometimes they call it robotic arm or manipulators, and the first type is the rectangular. Now this is cylindrical, spherical, and the jointed spherical or articulate. So let's begin with the first type. This is the rectangular arm geometry, otherwise known sometimes as the Cartesian robot or the Cartesian manipulator, because it moves along the Cartesian X, Y, and Z coordinates, as you can see here. It's also sometimes referred to as the 3P for prismatic or linear, or 3L for linear. And the biggest, best example of this is the overhead crane that you see in every factory. You can see the hook is moving along the X and Y and Z lines or linear motions without any orientational change, such as any angular change. It's just along the X and Y and Z coordinates. There are many other examples of the Cartesian robot or manipulators, which we will see later. But that's why it's referred to as the coordinate. As you can see from the motion of the end effector, it draws a rectangular shape or a rectangular work envelope. That's why it's excellent or perfect for a crane in a very big factory where it can pick and place, and it's also very reliable. Let's move on to the second type, which is the cylindrical arm geometry. It has two linear motion, X and Y, and then a rotational movement, which is the rotation you see about the Z axis. The X motion is called the height, and the Y motion is called the reach, and sometimes it's called R2P, one rotation and two prismatic. The cylindrical robot is excellent for handling and for movement. Because it's very centralized in its own center of gravity, it's very rigid and very structurally sound. So it also requires very small work area. The vertical linear motion is referred to as the stroke, or the height in some books. The extension horizontal motion is called the reach, and the rotational movement is referred to as the swing, sometimes referred to as the twist as in other books. Different sizes, and again, that's why it's called the cylindrical robot, because it can draw a cylindrical work envelope. And the work envelope is very large and of course limited on maximum and minimum reach of the arm. Yeah, application-wise, the cylindrical robot, as we said earlier, is excellent for handling and also very strong and stable in its own center of gravity, because it's relatively rigid. Now, let's talk about the second type, which is the spherical arm geometry. As we move on, if you notice, we are replacing rotations with prismatic. Now we have two rotations and one prismatic. The base is rotating and the shoulder is rotating and then the arm is extending. These spherical robots are excellent for to working on products to reach difficult to find or difficult to reach locations. And its movements, combination of the movements is very versatile. The rotational movement is referred to, as the base. The base of the robot can turn on itself, and the next turn is the shoulder, and the extension is once again referred to as the reach, because it can extend to reach to the point of interest. The work envelope for the spherical is obviously, as the name implies, a sphere, but that depends on several factors, such as the angles, the base angle, as well as the shoulder length and the shoulder angle, as well as the reach. So, although it looks like a cone or a cone with a bottle in between or a circle in between, that depends on how high or how low the spherical robot can reach. It's very versatile, but because of the rotational movement, is quite expensive. Also, it requires a wide range or a wide space or a footprint on the floor, so that could sometimes be a negative against it, because of that extended arm here. Now, the third part is sometimes referred to as the articulate or the revolute, or sometimes the revolute coordinates, or even the jointed spherical, because it has three rotations, one at the base, one at the shoulder, and one at the wrist. So base, shoulder, and elbow. So these are the three motions. And this is the most popular robot or type for industrial robots. The rotational motion is obviously the base. Then we have the shoulder, which is the next rotational joint. And then the next one after that is the elbow. So then the envelope that can be drawn here is a complete sphere again. But it's a kind of different sphere, or a full sphere now, because of the reach that this robot can reach. It's also a lot more universal compared to the spherical robot. The absence of the linear joint means that there is no extended arm hanging about. So this arm, this rotary or jointed spherical robot can reach extensive location without a big or a large footprint. Okay, let's get back to the slides. So now with the videos in mind, let's now move on to these robots again and take another look with great details into these different manipulators. So the first type that we saw before, it's the Cartesian rectangular manipulator. Cartesian rectangular, these are interchangeable terms. As you can see here, obviously it's a 3DOF manipulator because it has three independent motions. And these three independent motions are three prismatics or three linear. So it could be 3P for prismatic, but in some other books could be 3L for linear. It doesn't matter what the terminology is, as long as you understand there is actually three motions of along the Cartesian axis, X, Y, and Z. Examples, of course, is the overhead crane, and this, of course, is the tabletop, sometimes referred to as the table robot. And, of course, if you remember, we saw a couple of slides ago, the FarmBot robot. And you know what? Let's go and take another look at it from here. So FarmBot, yep. And FarmBot essentially is itself a Cartesian robot, as you can see. It moves along the X and Y and Z axis to perform its agriculture task, which is watering, feeding. But in essence, the robot here is a Cartesian robot. The rest of the control, the analysis, and the IoT has been discussed. But as you can see from here, from the motion, it can perform these operations, but essentially it is a Cartesian robot, as you can see here. Let's get back to our slide. Yeah. So now, next one. Also, another thing to notice is because of the motion of the end effector, the Cartesian robot draws a rectangular rectangle, as you can see. Sometimes that is why sometimes it's referred to as the rectangular manipulator. The Cartesian name comes from the name of the coordinates x, y, z. These are called Cartesian, and sometimes it's called rectangular because of the shape of the rectangle. Okay. The next robot that we saw earlier was the cylindrical robot, and that one is identified by the fact that the base can rotate the rectangular, the vertical motion up and down, and the reach of the arm, as you can see from here. Now, this is the limitation. This kind of robot, the linear joint, right? Why is it limited? Because if you want the arm here to extend to a very long location, let's say you want this arm to reach a very long distance, it has to have the, you know, the base of the arm also extended in the end. And that could limit, that could cause the robot to have a very large footprint on the floor. If you want to reduce that, to reduce the footprint, the reach of the robot will also become minimal. So that's a drawback for this kind of robot. But again, the reason why it's called the cylindrical is for this reason, because it can draw a cylindrical work envelope. And it's also called R2P because it's one rotation and two prismatic motions. One rotation is called the swing, sometimes it's called the twist, and then the two other linear motions are the stroke, sometimes called simply the height, and the extension is obviously called the reach. Now, the spherical manipulator is kind of difficult to see. We saw it earlier in the video, so I hope that was easier to understand its meaning. It has two rotational movements, one at the base, as you can see from here, and one at the shoulder. And then the arm extends. Now, the best example of a spherical manipulator is the ladder of the fire engine. That is why this guy is here. I am sure that you have seen a fire engine before, whether it's in real life or in a TV show or a cartoon. And you would remember how the ladder works. You have two joints, the base of it, and then you have the shoulder, and then the ladder itself extends along the line. That's exactly what this looks like. It's the base of the ladder, and then its shoulder, and then the ladder itself extends. So again, that's why it's called two RPs, two rotational and one prismatic. And it draws a spherical envelope, and that's why it's referred to as a spherical robot. The next robot is the Scara, or the name of Scara is really, I don't know why they call it, but I think they like the word Scara because the rest of their name is just a generic word, Selective Compliance Assembly Robot Arm. I really have no idea what selective compliance refer to here, but I know that the assembly robot is what it means. It's basically, that's why this kind of robot is mainly used for assembly, hence the name. And it really is it's an excellent pick and place robot. And that's why it actually, but it's kind of a weird and different configuration from the previous robot or manipulators and the one coming after this. But it's worth mentioning because it's one of the earliest examples of manipulators historically, and it's still one of the most popular used in factories worldwide because of its excellence in being a great pick and place robot. The work envelope is unique, as you can see here, and that's why we don't have a name for it. We just call it the Scara robot. It has two rotational joints, but they are all on the same plane, and then you have an extension or a linear motion, which is this vertical pin that goes up and down. So what happens is that this pick goes down, the gripper or the end effector does its jump, then goes back up, then moves to the other side, and then goes down again. And that can be repeatedly done very quickly, resulting in a very reliable and very resilient robot. Moving on, now this is the articulate or joint spherical manipulator. Now the articulate essentially is three rotations. You have the base, which is right here, and you have the shoulder, and you have the elbow. Now, the articulate is made of three rotations, so it can draw a perfect sphere, but unlike the cylindrical or the spherical robots, there is no linear joint and there is no arm in behind to extend. If you go back there again, and this is symbolic drawing here, it doesn't really do justice. Let's take a look at the realistic one here. So this is a realistic arm right here. In order to extend forward, it has to have some space in the back, as we have noticed in the videos. But this particular problem does not exist for the spherical or the jointed spherical or the articulated robot. You can reach all you want and there is nothing behind to have, and so therefore the footprint could be very minimal if you just bring the arm backward to the home position, like, or in the standing position like this, resulting in a very small footprint. At the same time, very large work envelope. When we started those manipulators, we mentioned that the Cartesian, we didn't say that. The Cartesian is the simplest to work with, is because it contains three linear motions. And linear motions, mathematically speaking, are very easy to work with because we can use direct algebra to develop the equations involved in the motion. So there is no problems there. But as you involve with angles, then now we have trigonometry. And trigonometry operations will be quite more complex the more angles you have. So for the cylindrical robot, we can manage it. And for the spherical robot, we can also manage it, although a little bit more work required. We can still solve the equations or work with the equations algebraically. And for the SCARA, although we have two joints, but they are on the same plane, so you can call it a planar robot. So that actually is also, a relatively speaking, simpler to work with. But when it comes to the articulated robot, this now, the beginning of the suffering, I call it. The three R or the three jointed, they, each one of them, not only we have three rotations, but each one of those rotations is in a different plane. This rotation, the base rotation, is about the Z axis. The Y rotation is about the Y axis. And the X rotation, I mean, in this particular example, they are on the same plane, the shoulder and the elbow. But in other applications, as you will see, that we might have it in a different plane altogether. Now, the concepts of planes and all that stuff, we will see when we talk about kinematics. But let us agree that the more angles we have, the more difficult the operations will become. And it will get to the point where doing it by hand, it will be impossible. You will need to use software to solve and develop these equations. Now, as I say that, just to let you know that this 3 degree of freedom manipulator, I mean articulated manipulator, is just the beginning. We have 5 degrees, we have 6 degrees, and even higher and higher. And essentially, the reason why would you want to have more degrees is because you want to have more complex motions. But the price for that is complex motions means complex analysis and complex design and more difficult things to work with. And that's just 6 degrees of freedom. Remember how many degrees of freedom is in your one wrist or one arm? So you should really appreciate the quality of your making, so to speak. So these are we will come back again to those manipulators when we talk about kinematics. We will focus our analysis on the first three. We will work with the Cartesian, definitely, cylindrical and spherical, and we will work with the articulate. The SCARA manipulator, we will see, but most likely or definitely we will work with Cartesian, cylindrical as spherical, and then we will also briefly talk about the articulate. We will also... we will not work with the SCARA, but we will work with planar robots. The robots that are on the same plane. Basically, it's exactly like this robot, but without this third joint over there. We will see that when we talk about kinematics. So let's move on to the second part of this video, which is the end effector. And the end effectors, as we discussed before, is the device or the item that you put at the end of the robot to provide the effect. And this could be a mechanical gripper, or it could be a tool that performs a job. And that's essentially what we see in front of us right here. So when it comes to a gripper, it could be many different types of grippers. This is a mechanical gripper. It's basically a clamp that can open and close to hold a device. But we could also have a humanoid gripper, as you can see from here, which mimics the human hand. We can also have different types of grippers. This is a roller that simply rolls over something. And this is a vacuum or suction cup gripper, magnetic gripper, adhesive or Velcro grippers. We have hook gripper. And we even have a poke gripper, which is simply have a needle on top in the end that pokes the item. And then it's like a knife or a fork, and then picks the item up. The choice of gripper mechanism or type depends on the product. If the item was small and not so heavy, we may use mechanical. If it's very light and the gripper could actually break it, we could use vacuum. If it's metallic and magnetic, we can use magnetic. If it's not, we could try and use adhesive, or we can even try to use hooks or Velcros. The humanoid grippers are not really used in the industry. They're used in social robotics and for robots that are interacting with humans, or for research when we're trying to study humanoid robotics. But in the industry, to my knowledge, it's not really used in industry, but only for social and for research purposes. Now we talk about the tools. Again, this could be a variety of options. You have grinding tools for surface treatments. It could be welding guns for welding robot operations. It could be spray painting nozzles for spray painting robots. Sensors for inspection sensors, and even a machining bit like a drill bit for machining robots. Once again, the choice of the tool in the end depends on the choice of the robot and its purpose. Network ready controllers, again, we talked about this before, but let's just go through it again. Raspberry Pi, it could be again an open source controller, or it could be a proprietary controller. The purpose of including network ready controllers is because of linking the robot to the cloud. If the controller itself is connected or can be connected to the cloud, then we can use the interface, or we can use the framework to transform or to broadcast robot information to wherever it is needed. So let's briefly talk about the Arduino and the Raspberry Pi chips, and very briefly, because it's only the theoretical part, but the electronics and the programming part will come in later sessions, on later videos. So what is the Arduino? The Arduino obviously is an open source electronic platform. Means it's not just the hardware, but it's also the support software as well. The board can actually read input from push buttons, sensors, and switches. It can also produce output to control LEDs, send a command to buzzers, turn a motor on, turn a servo motors. And Arduino boards can be programmed by uploading the set of instructions or the sketches. The program that we use to control an Arduino or to work with an Arduino is called the Arduino language, which itself is an extension of the C++ language. It's a very similar situation to how Android is an extension of Java. So if you are familiar with C++, then you are already familiar with Arduino. You just need to learn a few libraries and a few new methods, and you'll be good to go. Arduino itself has its own IDE, or Integrated Development Environment, where you can write your code and or sketches and then upload it to the Arduino board. The benefits of Arduino is that extremely cost effective. It's very, very cheap. Cross-platform, can work with any operating system. It's a simple and clear programming. It's very actually easy to write the code for it. I mean, the easiness is not about being an extension of C. It's itself, the IDE of it is organized in such a manner where you don't have to, you just have to focus on the code and the setup. You don't have to worry about a lot of other things in the background. And it's open source. Feel free to go and take a look at the Arduino original codes or libraries produced by others, and then you can learn from it, use it, customize it, and so on and so forth. And even the hardware itself is open source, meaning the design sketches for the board itself and its components is available online. You can design it, download it, and make your own hardware if you wish, or if you have the skills. There are many variety or various options of Arduinos. There's Uno, there's Nano, Mega, and MCU, which is a special. It's not really, there's a debate here whether it's part of Arduino or whether it's a standalone device. But the reason for that is because the MCU was sort of adopted by Arduino, the Arduino project. And here is the Arduino board and its map. I suggest you go through it. Every one of these pins have, some of these pins have special purposes, special features that you might want to go through those on your own time. This is the real microprocessor right here. And you can actually read the code from here. And the rest is the circuit that is built in to work with the controller. Now, this is a good place to talk about this course. You can see that, and this actually, this controller right here is already built in with the board. And this is it's actually quite bigger than the real size. The real Arduino probably is this size, which is roughly the size of your bank card or ID card or something like that. I just enlarged it a little bit to allow you to see the components. You have input ports, you have IOs, input-output pins, power source, and miscellaneous components to allow you to work with it. If you ever wondered where the name Arduino came from, and this is a true story, it's the name of the cafe where the original creators, you know, the original people are the people who created Arduino. The first meeting they had was in a cafe called Arduino in Italy. And so they decided to name the project after their favorite hangout place. It's a true story. So that's why the name is catchy, and that's why it's still with us. The Raspberry Pi is it's not a controller and chip, it's a computer and chip. You see, the Arduino is, although it's a controller and it's nice and all, but it does not work on it. I mean, let me rephrase that. When you are programming it, you need to have another system. You need the help of another system. You need to hook up the Arduino to another laptop or a computer. Then from there, you need to install the IDE and write your program and then upload it to the Arduino. Once it's uploaded, then the Arduino can run on its own. But during the programming stage, you will need to hook it up to another laptop or a computer in order to give it the instructions. This is not required for the Raspberry Pi. The Raspberry Pi is a standalone computer. All you need to do is hook it up with a monitor and keyboard and mouse, and you're good to go. It's the equivalent to the CPU box on your computer at home. So that's what the Raspberry... I'm going to skip through the theory stuff. You can read it, but then basically this chip, right, this is actually almost the real size, almost exactly the real size of the real Raspberry Pi. And unlike the Arduino, this is a complete built-in chip, a computer, minus of course monitor and keyboard or input-output devices. But over here you will have, this is a slightly older device, Pi. I think it's, I think over here, apart from the DSI display connector, you also have the SD card, which is the memory or the hard drive, so to speak. And over here is the audio or the video jack, and you have HDMI plot and camera connector for camera. I actually worked with this one. And you have also micro USB power. This is the power source. You connect it to the power source. The adapter, and these are four USB units to connect, and this is an Ethernet cable for connection also. Apart from this, you also have a built-in Bluetooth and Wi-Fi connectivity. But aside from all of that, this chip right here contains the motherboard, the graphic card, the microprocessor, the CPU, all of it in one shot. And all you need to do is connect by USB or HDMI for that matter, your monitor, keyboard, and mouse, and you will have a full computer running on it. And once you start it, it will have its own Linux, special Linux operating system called Raspbian. And then from then on, you can then work with the Arduino. You can then write the program and so on and so forth. So this is essentially the, this right here is this, see this? This GPIO or general purpose input-output pins, these actually, or every individual pins here, they are not random. They are actually, although they don't have, you don't see any numbers here, but they are numbered. Unlike the Arduino, you have to count on your own. In the Arduino board, you actually can see the numbers, which is very lovely. So you can actually save yourself the headache of counting. And sometimes even labeled, like this is A means here in analog, and these are digital. But for the Raspberry Pi, these are all digital, there is no analog. And also, in order for you to know which pin belongs to what, you will have to have a map nearby. So this is the map right here. This is essentially what every pin here is for. Some of them is for grounding, some of them for power source, and some of them for GPIOs, and some of them for special pins, as you can see from here. But just put in mind that these two are actually these two. So if you turn it to 90 degrees, you can and put these on top and go down, so you will see this view right here. Okay, and now the programming side of things, the coding and all of that stuff, that will be discussed in later videos. But for now, hopefully we have developed now a good understanding of what industrial robots are, the different kinds of manipulator, Cartesian, cylindrical, and spherical, as well as the scalar and articulate. And we talked about ND vectors, and we talked about network ready controllers. In the next chapter, we will talk about robot kinematics. And this is where we begin to, this is where things begin to become really heavy. And the topic of kinematics is quite extensive, and it will last several weeks. After we are done with that, then we will move on to robot control and programming. This is where we are here. So think of this part as the foundation for kinematics, and think of this part, I mean, both of these are foundation for kinematics, and think of this part as the foundation for programming or controller programming. So I will see you in the next video when we talk about kinematics. So all the best, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care.